Hello friends, welcome to our today's topics. Today we will discuss about infective endocarditis. This is caused by microbial infection of a heart valve, the lining of a cardiac chamber or blood vessel, or by a congenital anomaly. Both nave and prosthetic valves can be affected. The most common causes of infective endocarditis are streptococci and staphylococci, but other organisms may also be involved. Epidemiology. The incidence of infective endocarditis in community-based studies ranges from 5 to 15 cases per 1 lakh per annum. More than 50% of patients are over 60 years of age. In a large British study, the underlying condition was rheumatic heart disease in 24% of patients, congenital heart disease in 19%, and other cardiac abnormalities such as calcified aortic valve or floppy mitral valve in 25%. The remaining 32% were not thought to have a pre-existing cardiac abnormality. Bacterial endocarditis is a serious illness. The case fatality is approximately 20% even with treatment, and is even higher in those with prosthetic valve endocarditis and those infected with antibiotic resistant organisms. Now, the pathophysiology. Infective endocarditis typically occurs at sites of pre-existing endocardial damage, but infection with particularly virulent or aggressive organisms such as Staphylococcus aureus can cause endocarditis in a previously normal heart. Staphylococcal endocarditis of the tricuspid valve is a common complication of intravenous drug use. Many acquired and congenital cardiac lesions are vulnerable, particularly areas of endocardial damage caused by a high-pressure jet of blood, such as ventricular septal defect, mitral regurgitation, and aortic regurgitation, many of which are hemodynamically insignificant. In contrast, the risk of endocarditis at the site of hemodynamically important low-pressure lesions such as large atrial septal defect is minimal. Infection tends to occur at sites of endothelial damage because they attract deposits of platelets and fibrin that are vulnerable to colonization of blood-borne organisms. The avascular valve tissue and presence of fibrin and platelet aggregates help to protect proliferating organisms from host defense mechanisms. When the infection is established, vegetations composed of organisms, fibrin, and platelets grow and may become large enough to cause obstruction or embolism. Adjacent tissues are destroyed and abscesses may form. Valve regurgitation may develop or increase if the affected valve is damaged by tissue distortion, cusp perforation, or disruption of chordae. Extracardiac manifestations such as vasculitis and skin lesions may occur as the result of either emboli or immune complex deposition. Mycotic aneurysms may develop in arteries at the site of infected emboli. In fatal cases, infarction of the spleen and kidneys and sometimes an immunoglobulinephritis may be found at postpartum. Endocarditis in old age. Symptoms and signs may be non-specific with delirium, weight loss, malaise and weakness, and the diagnosis may not be suspected. Common causative organisms, often enterococci from the urinary tract and Streptococcus galolyticus, galolyticus from a colonic source. Morbidity and mortality is much higher. Here is the microbiology of infective endocarditis. The pathogen are Staphylococci, which are Staphylococcus aureus, coagulase negative, Streptococci oral and others non-enterococci, and Enterococcus species, H group, polymicrobial, other bacteria, fungi, negative blood culture. Now, the microbiology. Over 3/4 of cases are caused by Streptococci or Staphylococci, Virulence streptococci such as Streptococcus mitis and Streptococcus sanguis, which are common cells in the oral cavity, can enter the bloodstream on chewing or toothbrushing or at the time of dental treatment and are common causes of subacute endocarditis. Other organisms including Enterococcus faecalis, Enterococcus faecium and Streptococcus gallolyticus subspecific gallolyticus, previously known as Streptococcus vobis, may enter the blood from the bowel or urinary tract. Patients who are found to have endocarditis caused by Streptococcus gallolyticus should undergo colonoscopy, since this organism is associated with large bowel malignancy. Staphylococcus aureus has now overtaken Streptococci as the most common cause of acute endocarditis. It originates from skin infections, abscesses or vascular access sites such as intravenous and central lines, or from intravenous drug use. It is highly virulent and invasive, usually producing florid vegetation, rapid valve destruction and abscess formation. Other causes of acute endocarditis include Streptococcus pneumoniae and Streptococcus pyogenes. Postoperative endocarditis after cardiac surgery may affect native or prosthetic heart valves or other prosthetic materials. The most common organisms are coagulase negative staphylococci such as Staphylococcus epidermidis, which are part of the normal skin flora. There is frequently a history of own infection with the same organism. Coagulase negative staphylococci cause native bulb endocarditis in approximately 5% of cases, and this possibility should always be considered before they are dismissed as blood culture contaminants. Another coagulase negative staphylococcus, Staphylococcus lugdunensis, causes a rapidly destructive acute endocarditis that is associated with previously normal valves and multiple emboli. Unless accurately identified, it may also be overlooked as a contaminant. In Q fever endocarditis due to coxilla burnet tip, the patient often has a history of contact with farm animals. The aortic valve is usually affected, and there may also be hepatitis, pneumonia, and purpura. Lifelong antibiotic therapy may be required. In about 3-4% of cases, endocarditis may be caused by gram-negative bacteria of the so-called Hatchet group. Hatchet groups H for Haemophilus acrophilus, known as aggregative vector acrophilus, aggregative vector actinomycetin mycomitans, and Cardiobacterium hominis, Echinella cordens, and Kinjella kinjai. These are slowly growing fastidious gram-negative organisms that are oropharyngeal commensals. The diagnosis may be revealed only after prolonged culture, and the organisms may be resistant to penicillin. Brucella endocarditis is associated with a history of contact with goats or cattle and often affects the aortic valve. Yeast and fungi such as Candida and Aspergillus may attack previously normal or prosthetic valves, particularly in immunocompromised patients or those with indwelling intravenous catheters. Abscesses and emboli are common. Therapy is difficult. Surgery is often required and mortality is high. Concomitant bacterial infection may be present. Now the clinical features. Endocarditis can take either an acute or a more insidious subacute form. There is considerable overlap, however, because the clinical pattern is influenced not only by the organism but also by the site of infection, prior antibiotic therapy, and the presence of a bulb or shunt prosthesis. The subacute form may abruptly develop acute life-threatening complications such as bulb disruption or emboli. The due criteria for diagnosis of infective endocarditis are shown in the box. Subacute endocarditis. This should be suspected when a patient with congenital or valvular heart disease develops a persistent fever, complains of unusual tiredness, night sweats, or weight loss, or develops new signs of valve dysfunction or heart failure. Less often, it presents as an embolic stroke or peripheral arterial embolism. Other features include purpura and petechial hemorrhages in the skin and mucous membranes, and splinter hemorrhages under the fingernails or toenails. Osler's nodes are painful, tender swelling at the fingertips that are probably the product of vasculitis. They are rare. Digital clubbing is a late sign. The spleen is frequently palpable. In coxillar infections, the spleen and the liver may be considerably enlarged. Non-visible hematuria is common. The finding of any of these features in a patient with persistent fever or malaise is an indication for re-examination to detect hitherto unrecognized heart disease. Acute endocarditis. This presents as a severe febrile illness with prominent and changing heart murmurs and petechiae. Clinical stigmata of chronic endocarditis are usually absent. Embolic events are common and cardiac or renal failure may develop rapidly. Abscesses may be detected on echocardiography. Partially treated acute endocarditis behaves like subacute endocarditis. Now, post-operative endocarditis. This may present as an unexplained fever in a patient who has had heart valve surgery. The infection usually involves the valve ring and may resemble subacute or acute endocarditis, depending on the virulence of the organism. Morbidity and mortality are high, and revision surgery is often required. The range of organisms is similar to that seen in native valve disease. But when endocarditis occurs during the first few weeks after surgery, it is usually due to infection with a coagulase negative staphylococcus that was introduced during the perioperative period. Here the clinical features shows clinical features of infective endocarditis. There is subconjunctival hemorrhage, which occurs in 2-5% of cases. There is varying murmurs, 90% new or changed murmur. There may be conduction disorder. It occurs in 10-20% cases. There may be cardiac failure, 40-50% cases. Hematuria, 60-70% cases. Osler's nodes, 5% cases. Petechial rash, 40-50%, may be transient. There may be cerebral emboli in 50% cases. Rod spots in fundi, that is rare, less than 5%. Petechial hemorrhages on mucous membranes and fundi, 20-30% cases. Poor dentition, splenomegaly, 30-40% cases. Long-standing endocarditis only. Systemic emboli, 7%, and nail fold infarcts. There may be presence of loss of pulses and systemic emboli, 7%, we have said, nail fold infarcts. There may be digital clubbing in 10% cases, and it occurs long-standing endocarditis only. Splinter hemorrhages in 10% cases. Diagnosis of infective endocarditis. There are major criteria and minor criteria. Among major criteria, there is positive blood culture and endocardial involvement. Positive blood culture, typical organism from two cultures. Persistent positive blood cultures taken more than 12 hours apart. Three or more positive cultures taken over more than 1 hour apart. And endocardial involvement includes positive echocardiographic findings of vegetations or new valvular regurgitation. Among minor criteria, there is predisposing valvular or cardiac abnormality, intravenous drug misuse, pyrexia more than or equal to 38 degrees Celsius, embolic phenomenon, vasculitic phenomenon, blood culture suggestive, organism grown but not achieving major criteria, suggestive echocardiographic findings. So modified Duke criteria, patients with two major or one major and three minor or five minor have definite endocarditis. Patients with one major and one minor or three minor have possible endocarditis. Now, the investigations. Blood culture is the pivotal investigation to identify the organism that is the cause of the infection and to guide antibiotic therapy. 3 to 6 sets of blood culture should be taken prior to commencing therapy and should not wait for episodes of pyrexia. The first two specimens will detect bacteremia in 90% of culture positive cases. A meticulous aseptic technique is essential. Taking discrete sets of blood cultures from peripheral sites at intervals of 6 hours or more than 6 hours reduces the risk of misdiagnosis due to contamination with skin commensals. Isolation of a typical organism in more than one culture provides strong evidence in favor of the diagnosis. An indwelling line should not be used to take cultures. Both aerobic and anaerobic cultures are required. Echocardiography is key for detecting and following the progress of vegetations, for assessing bulb damage, and for detecting abscess formation. Vegetation as small as 2 to 4 mm can be detected by transthoracic echocardiography, and even smaller ones, 1 to 1.5 mm, can be visualized by transesophageal echocardiography, which is particularly valuable for identifying abscess formation and investigating patients with prosthetic heart valves. Vegetations may be difficult to distinguish in the presence of an abnormal valve. The sensitivity of transthoracic echo is approximately 65%, but that of transesophageal echo is more than 90%. Failure to detect vegetations does not exclude the diagnosis. Elevation of the ESR and normocytic normochromic anemia and leukocytosis are common but not invariable. Measurement of serum CRP is more reliable than the ESR in monitoring progress. Proteinuria may occur and non-visible hematuria is usually present. The ECG may show the development of AV block due to aortic root abscess formation and occasionally infarction due to emboli. The chest X-ray may show evidence of cardiac failure and cardiomegaly. Now, the management. A multidisciplinary approach with cooperation between the physician, surgeon, and microbiologist increases the chance of a successful outcome. Any source of infection should be removed as soon as possible. For example, a tooth with an apical abscess should be extracted. Empirical treatment depends on the mode of presentation, the suspected organism, and the presence of a prosthetic valve or penicillin allergy. If the presentation is subacute, antibiotic treatment should ideally be withheld until the results of blood cultures are available. However, if empirical antibiotic treatment is considered necessary, amoxicillin 2 g 6 times daily IV should be considered with or without gentamicin. If the presentation is acute, empirical therapy should be started with vancomycin 1 g twice daily IV and gentamicin 1 mg per kg twice daily IV, with dose adjustment based on antibiotic levels. The same regimen is used in true penicillin allergy. Patients with suspected prosthetic valve endocarditis should be treated with vancomycin and gentamicin at the above mentioned doses, plus rifampicin orally in a dose of 300 to 600 mg twice daily. Following identification of the causal organism, determination of the minimum inhibitory concentration, that is MIC, for the organism helps guide antibiotic therapy. Recommended regimens for some of the most common scenarios are shown in box. More detailed informations can be found in the 2012 British Society for Antimicrobial Chemotherapy Guidelines. A 2-week treatment regimen may be sufficient for fully sensitive strains of streptococci, provided specific conditions are met. Cardiac surgery with debridement of infected material and bulb replacement may be required in a substantial proportion of patients, particularly those with Staphylococcus aureus and fungal infections. Antimicrobial therapy must be started before surgery. Prevention. Until recently, antibiotic prophylaxis was routinely given to people at risk of infective endocarditis undergoing interventional procedures. However, as this has not been proven to be effective and the link between episodes of infective endocarditis and interventional procedures has not been demonstrated, antibiotic prophylaxis is no longer offered routinely. Conditions for the short course treatment of endocarditis caused by fully sensitive streptococci. The conditions are native bulb infection, minimum inhibitory concentration, that is MIC less than or equal to 0.125 mg per liter, no adverse prognostic factors, that is heart failure, aortic regurgitation, conduction defect, no evidence of thromboembolic disease, no vegetations more than 5 mm diameter, clinical response within 7 days. Now, what are the indications for cardiac surgery in infective endocarditis? The indications are heart failure due to bulb damage, failure of antibiotic therapy, persistent uncontrolled infection, large vegetations on left-sided heart valves with echo appearance suggesting high risk of emboli, previous evidence of systemic emboli, abscess formation. Patients with prosthetic valve endocarditis or fungal endocarditis often require cardiac surgery. Here is the antimicrobial treatment of common causative organisms in infective endocarditis. For streptococci, where penicillin MIC is equal to or less than 0.125 mg per liter, the antibiotic of choice is benzyl penicillin IV. Dose is 1.2 grams 6 times daily. Duration for native valve is 4 weeks, for prosthetic valve is 6 weeks. For penicillin MIC more than 1.125 but less than 0.5 mg per liter, the treatment of choice is benzyl penicillin IV and gentamicin IV. Dose is 2.4 gram 6 times daily for benzyl penicillin IV and 1 mg per kg twice daily for gentamicin IV. For the duration for native bulb for benzyl penicillin is 4 weeks and prosthetic bulb 6 weeks and gentamicin 2 weeks and 2 weeks. Penicillin MIC more than 0.5 mg per liter. Here the antibiotic choice is vancomycin IV and gentamicin. Vancomycin, the dose is 1 gram twice daily. Duration is 4 weeks for native bulbs and 6 weeks for prosthetic bulbs. And gentamicin IV 1 mg per kg twice daily, 4 weeks for native bulb and 6 weeks for prosthetic bulb. For enterococci, amoxicillin MIC less than 4 mg per liter and gentamicin MIC less than 128 mg per liter. The drug of choice is amoxicillin IV and gentamicin IV. And amoxicillin dose 2 grams 6 times daily for 4 weeks for native bulbs and 6 weeks for prosthetic bulbs. For gentamicin IV 1 mg per kg twice daily, 4 weeks for native bulbs and 6 weeks for prosthetic bulbs. And amoxicillin MIC more than 4 mg per liter and gentamicin MIC less than or equal to 128 mg per liter. Here drug of choice is vancomycin IV and gentamicin IV. Vancomycin IV dose is 1 gram twice daily and 4 weeks for native bulbs and 6 weeks for prosthetic bulbs. And gentamicin dose is 1 mg per kg twice daily and duration is 4 weeks for native bulbs and 6 weeks for prosthetic bulbs. For staphylococci native bulb, here if methicillin sensitive, we can give flucloxacillin IV. The dose is 2 gram 4 to 6 times daily for 4 weeks. Methicillin resistant, vancomycin MIC less than 2 mg per liter and rifampicin sensitive, then our drug of choice is vancomycin IV and rifampicin orally or vancomycin IV dose is 1 gram twice daily. 1 gram twice daily for 4 weeks and rifampicin orally 300 to 600 milligram twice daily for 4 weeks. And staphylococci for prosthetic valve. And if methicillin sensitive, we will give flucloxacillin IV and gentamicin IV and rifampicin orally. For flucloxacillin dose is 2 gram 4 to 6 times daily for 6 weeks. For gentamicin IV, 1 milligram per kg twice daily for 6 weeks. And rifampicin orally 300 to 600 milligram twice daily for 6 weeks. And methicillin resistant, vancomycin MIC less than 2 mg per liter and rifampicin sensitive cases, we will give vancomycin IV and rifampicin orally. For vancomycin IV, the dose is 1 gram twice daily for 6 weeks and rifampicin orally 300 to 600 mg twice daily for 6 weeks. Thank you friends for your patience hearing.